Wrong button. Okay. Hi, this is Ed, and welcome back to Global TV Talk Show. Our very special guest today is also in Southern California. Yeah, it's Christian Turnetin, and he's in Orange County. Okay, Michael is going to be joining at 30 minutes past. Okay. I'm going to, pardon me, I'm just going to say, okay. Okay, Michael Jackson will be joining us, and but at around half past the hour. Is that okay for you?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So everybody out there in the world, Christian, many years experience as an executive with relocation management companies, and his real love is linguistics. So tell us about linguistics.
One of them, yeah. So linguistics is where my original background is. I have a master's in linguistics from the University of Zurich, Switzerland. And when I went to the UK for my exchange year, that's also one of the subjects I studied there. Linguistics is a huge field, and there are so many special niches and pieces, and it's been around for several hundred years also. But within that, my specialty is in pragmatics, which is the field of the difference between what you're saying and what you mean. And it's something that you use to, for instance, explain things like irony, sarcasm, double entendres, all that. It's applied language. And I wrote my master's thesis on politeness in business environments. And I analyzed how you save face in or give face in business settings. So for instance, approving what somebody says in front of a group of people is giving face, saving face, you apologize, things like that, concepts like that. And as academic as that sounds, it's served me well in my career in mobility, where you work on high-level customer service and you do that kind of thing literally every day. That you think in those terms.
So this
So
is very intellectual, but it's
it
also
was a master's thesis. Yeah.
very practical.
Yes, that's what I liked about it, that it was both. I already knew that at the time when I wrote it, I already had an inkling that I didn't want to be a high school teacher. I had most of the classwork done for becoming an English and history teacher. And I taught for 6 months, substituting for my old English teachers. I taught at my old high school, which was a whole other story I have to tell you about one
I
day.
bet.
It's bizarre. And it was also my mom's high school. So yeah. Anyway, I decided I can't really handle teenagers that well and their disciplinary problems. And that's when I decided to really go into the business world with my English degree. So how do you bridge that, right? Well, one of the ways you do it is to go into marketing. And I did that for several years, moved to the United States, did some marketing, and then with a few detours, moved into mobility.
So when you say marketing, I have a degree in marketing,
Yes.
undergraduate degree, and it was all about strategy and, manipulation, really, the psychology of that kind of, getting things done,
Right.
and, creating awareness and causing that awareness to create purchasing of a product, and then all things supportive of that, and So, what do you,
What did
what
I
was
do?
your, what was your experience level?
So what I did is I was hired as a really hands-on marketing guy to produce brochures, for instance, and produce them in German and English. So that was one of the attractions that I was able to translate. They didn't need a translator. I did it in-house. And also to handle some of the suppliers who only spoke English. Now, my boss spoke English, but he wasn't comfortable with this international Outlook working out of Switzerland. Yeah, so I did that. I did trade shows. I did I helped with the managing the customer database, updating that. It was a very hands-on kind of marketing, jack of all trades experience, and it helped me quite a bit. It kind of ran its course, and then I moved to the United States. Worked for a software company there, a Taiwanese software company, did their marketing, same deal, brochures and so on.
So let me ask you, going back to that first segment, what product or products?
Oh, yeah, sorry, I didn't mention that. It was Internet Security Solutions.
Okay.
So it was, virus
I don't know what
protection.
to say. Okay.
It was virus protection,
Yeah.
firewalls, that kind of stuff. And the company I worked for at the time worked with some of the large Swiss banks, insurance companies. Well, those were the big ones, advertising agencies,
Yeah.
healthcare, some of the pharma companies. So they had a really nice portfolio of clients.
So let me ask you, what was the job to do? You mentioned writing brochures
Right,
and
writing
did
brochures.
sales pitches?
No, they were my boss and another guy were the salespeople, but they needed to, they need, like you did, they need to hand something out. I designed a business card. I did quite a bit of graphic design together with a designer because I'm not that good at it, frankly.
No,
I
me
was
neither.
I looped my brother in, my middle brother, who had a one-person website design shop. He redesigned the website, he and I, and then I translated it from German into English. So it was a whole it, the whole deal of, okay, where I can't do all the marketing communications by myself. I need somebody else to do it who can do it in English as well. And that's why I was hired. And I worked there for about 2 years and then I moved.
Did you like the kind of work?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah.
I did. And it was nice to get out of academia and teaching and really get into the business world, figure out what a supply chain was, things like that. It was really, I learned so much.
That would be a good bridge. Yeah.
Yeah, it was an excellent bridge.
Yeah.
And then it was a jumping off point for starting my career in the United States.
Now, in the United States, how did you end up getting into the mobility business? I mean, what was the connection?
It was very simple. It was an ad on monster.com.
Mm-hmm.
And they were looking, and it was Cartus, and they were looking for a mobility, basically a relocation consultant, and international experience, multilingual. That's what all the things they wanted there. And I fit the bill. I got an interview with my hiring manager, who was a very nice, very smart lady from Annecy, which is on Lake Geneva, so on the French side of Switzerland. And we clicked immediately, and she made me an offer the next day. And that's how I started out as an international relocation consultant, then added some domestic renters and so on to it. I did a lot of assignment management, so what we're talking about often in your show. A lot of that I did for some of the well-known, software companies, but even down to companies that moved like 2 people a year. Then I went to Lexicon and really got into domestic relocations as well. So home sale, appraisals, the whole nine yards there.
So let me ask you a question about the communication skills and how you used your comfort and depth of knowledge and understanding of language to communicate a need. And an opportunity for a customer to take advantage of your company's product and maybe what to do with the product.
So do you mean in mobility or in marketing? Because I use them in
It's all
both,
the same,
but very
yeah.
differently. So in mobility, where you you're asked to, on the one hand, deliver high-level customer service, but on the other hand, you're working for the client, which is the company, the employer. So you have to stay within your guidelines, and you have to also sometimes put your foot down and say, no, you're not getting this, what you want, because it's outside of policy, and it's maybe even a crazy request, costs too much. So what you learn is to be very diplomatic about how you communicate that, because you cannot say no very strongly unless you absolutely have to. You have to learn how to put this in a form that makes a lot more sense. For instance, by saying, we can do this another way, or this is beyond the scope of your policy, but here's another thing I could do for you. You'll use a lot of the same tactics that you'd use in sales and marketing. Oh, also, I sold cars for 7 months. That was kind of an interlude. So that's where I learned sales. But you do it in a very diplomatic way. And because of my background, it's kind of the way I describe it. In the back of my head, I was constantly analyzing what I was saying, what the other person was saying, applying this linguistic model that I talked about. So it made it, in a way, it made it a lot easier to find the right words. And then also, I could do it in German. So I had transferees. I had a big software company client moving people from Germany and other places into the Bay Area, but the company is German. So, I could use all the experience I'd had moving into the United States. What is a credit history? Why can't you just get your household goods when you want them to? How do you open up a bank account? Things like that. I had done all that myself.
Yeah,
So
hands
there
on.
was
Yeah.
exactly. So there was a lot that I could share with them that they could immediately relate to.
So the theme of this show is how to reduce stress and anxiety when looking for a job. But what we've been talking on so far is nothing to do with stress other than you compensate and go around the issue of stress and anxiety by intellectualizing through your internal and then expressing it either in writing or speaking to change the topic or to take more control or to dodge an issue. So, in other words, the goal is to reduce any stress and anxiety by getting ahead of it and controlling the situation, controlling the ground
Yes.
game by the use of language.
Yes, and by the use of your what you share your knowledge, all the teaching skills that I learned in front of a class of 30 high school students. All that came into play too. How do you explain something? How do you, the other day I talked about what's in it for me. How do you explain that so that the people are with you? Because ultimately, yes, the immediate goal is to reduce stress and anxiety, also mostly on part of your transferee who's in a very stressful situation moving. But the real goal is to get them safely to where they need to be. And make them happy and relaxed so that they can go to the destination location and start being productive. That's the ultimate goal. And you need to do this within the rules or the policy work of the company that hired you, that paid you. Where it gets very difficult and challenging is when there's real estate involved. On a domestic side, when you have home sales, home purchases. And if you can pull all that off and they're sitting in their new home, they're happy, their household goods haven't been trashed, everything arrived in good stead, and you managed it so that they had the least amount of stress possible, that's when it is very satisfying because that's when people are grateful and appreciative.
So the whole relocation process is full of stress and anxiety.
It is on both. So it is on their part for sure, right? But then you come in and you're the one who's moved so many people before. You've been through it all. And if you've been through it all yourself, personal experience like I have, then it's even better. And you come in and you're the calming presence, ideally. You're the person that has it under control. You're the person that has already thought things through. You're going to arrive. Where are you going to stay? Oh, I don't know. All right, let's figure this out. Here's how this is going to work. I'm going to, work with our suppliers and get you a nice corporate apartment where you can stay for 30 days. And in the meantime, you can look for a home, and I have help there too. And you kind of you tell them how you're going to make all this happen, and you convey in your tone and in your communication style that you know what you're doing and that they can trust you and that you will see to it that they have a good experience with you, that you're there to support them, and that you're ultimately there to help them transition into their new destination and into their new role. Might be the same title, but in another location.
I'd like to go around the corner here, use a
Let's.
language, and bring in another topic, but definitely related to what has just been discussed. And that is this concept of stakeholders coming together to design, map, engineer an assignment, whether it's domestic or international, it doesn't matter. But not allowing a transferee to go out without a map of what is expected, with checkpoints along the way, preset dates, and what's expected and what is needed for an appraisal meeting, if you will, to help the assignee and family, we'll get to that in a minute, the assignee have their own ROI, return on their own investment in taking the assignment, because there's a lot of risk involved.
There
If they
is.
blow it, or if they do something wrong, or they get the company in trouble because of something that they do.
Or they make the wrong financial decisions.
And all of that is impacted if there's a family or a spouse, especially in a dual career situation, it becomes a mess. It becomes problematical, and it could cause a divorce. And I don't know what the legal ramifications for the company are by having an assignment go bad and resulting in a divorce, and which it can be very expensive for the assignee, never mind disruptive and damaging. And to what extent you, as the leader, manager, and the communicator, help with the stakeholders to prevent that from happening by mapping out the assignment first, with goalposts and checkpoints along the way. And that includes having a mentor and a coach at certain times, not 100% of the time, but making sure the assignee is trained to manage themselves and manage the family, so that the family doesn't wall themselves off from the new neighbors and the community, and that causes mental health problems, and lack of assimilation causes bitterness and disappointment. So that's a mess. That's a handful. Yet many companies don't prepare the assignee in that way.
That is one of the things that I'm thinking about a lot and have also written about in some posts. There's a second article that's going to come out that I'm co-writing with Mehibe Hill, the co mobility coach from Europe. What I firmly believe is the best way to go about this is for the company to start with the transferee when they discuss the job requirements. That is something that kind of comes natural, right? You would say you'll be in this role, and here's your job description, here's the projects you'll be working on. but then also to be trained enough to say, as far as getting you there, this is what we're doing. We have hired a relocation management company. They will be in touch with you. They will explain the policy benefits. And then, without going into too much detail, making sure that they're comfortable enough to know we'll be taken care of. I don't have the detail. I'm going to get the details from my contact at the RMC, but I'm taken care of. Somebody's thought this through, and it's just the details are being outsourced to the experts. Then the relocation management consultant comes into play, and ideally, what they say and what the transferee's been told internally aligned. Now, that's not always happening, and it should happen. I've had, of course, clients that did that really well, and I've had clients that said, "Well, I'm outsourcing it. You guys take over." And often then there's misalignment. As far as the divorce situation goes, yes, I've had this a few times. Where there's a possible divorce or there's definitely a rift in the family. What you can do is listen for signals, for cues. And if it jeopardizes the timeline of the relocation, you should notify the contact, HR, without going into too much detail. But they have a, you said stakeholders, they have a massive stake in this to make sure that their employee gets to the destination location on time. And one of the tools that you'd use is to make sure that the timeline and where you are is being communicated to the company. Classic example, somebody's just not is ghosting you, not responding to you. Why would they be doing this? Well, one of the possible reasons is they really don't want to move and they can't express that. So what they're doing is they're just not picking up the phone. And nothing happens, right? Because you have to develop the timeline with the transferee that's moving. So if somebody ghosts you, I've told my team when I manage my team, you must tell me and you must tell the client contact the account manager who's the liaison between the RMC and the client contact. You must tell all of us, notify us, because that jeopardizes a lot more than just a relocation. So you listen for those cues, you find out if the timeline is such that maybe dual career off that often happens. The spouse doesn't move immediately, the spouse moves 6, 7, 8 months later. Then you have to, bake that into the plan. Who's going to move when? Maybe there's children that are in college and they're moving from another location later. You are, as the relocation consultant, and that's what I just kept preaching to my team, you are in control of that timeline. You're the one that manages the timeline, and everything else that you just said hinges on the timeline. If there's a delay because there's a rift in the family, impacts the timeline. Transferee has financial issues, can't sell, impacts the timeline. So you have to listen for those cues because they're impacting your timeline. It's just like any other project. If there's a problem with your resources and you have obstacles, you have to communicate so that the whole thing doesn't derail.
So, what do you do? How can you explain to the transferee family who is probably bristling with anger or confusion, and fear? And downright being uncomfortable.
Yes.
And that is a mess. So why was that person picked for the assignment? And whose fault is that? And you can't, who are you to, it's not an imposter system situation. It's a dangerous situation because you're going to have an enemy inside that company if you accuse that line manager for not doing their job. And they're going to say, who are you to tell me that? Well, he said, because I'm trained to do this when a transferee situation, blah, blah, blah. And you're not helping your transferee be successful.
What you often do is, so two answers there. First of all, that's where a good client contact comes in that works for the employer and that would work with the line manager. Now you can,
So would that be a human resource
a human
business
resource
partner?
person or mobility person within human resources, yes. They know what impact this situation, this scenario you just outlined would have on the business on the one hand, which is something the RMC doesn't know, and then also, but also on the logistics of the timeline of the relocation. Example, if somebody moves, has to move fast, and it's summer and there's no movers available or no moving trucks available, timeline is going to be changed. So you have that person, and that person, and possibly even the hiring manager. You can explain to what the cause and effect is. You can be very factual and set the right expectations. And in my experience, that has helped a lot to not make them en your enemy. Because at the end of the day, you're trying to help move this project forward. And you're not go around blaming or accusing at all. You're just saying, you know, we're running into this obstacle. Could you talk to your transferee to the person that works in your team and say, hey, if you go through a location management company, you're not going to be there at the new site working on this and this date that we want, because all these things in between to get you from A to B are not going to be in place. They need to plan for you. And of course, you always have exceptions. You have people that are unreasonable, delusional, whatever, they have addiction problems, whatever the case may be, you get it all. But the vast majority of people are reasonable and they will say, okay, I want to make this a success. As you said earlier, my career is on the line, right? I want to make this a success. I'm going to play along and make sure that we all get to the same end result. That's how you convince them most of the time, that you're being factual. You're saying, if you don't do A, then B will happen. That's not an accusation, it's just a fact. Then that's what I
Thanks.
taught my
Thank you.
team.
So your language skills and poise and self-comfort, those are critical skills for that position. Well, for any position, but for sure in being
Yes.
in the middle of a management thing, a relocation, but it's a total management.
It is a, I think it's a very high skill level of customer service and project management at the same time, which is why it's not an easy job to do. I personally believe it takes about a year to train somebody to do it well and comfortably. Can they do it before? Yes, but you know, you need a certain level of experience to do it well and comfortably. And then your job as the manager and coach becomes to see where there's room for improvement, where's there skills that maybe you can share and teach so that your team, your consultants get even better at their jobs. And of course, you also have escalations like any manager, supervisor would, right? You have somebody who is deeply unhappy, and then it's up to you to help come up with solutions to defuse the situation, bring everybody back together at the table, to the table. And again, the end goal is always to move the person from A to B, to make sure that what has to happen happens. And when I train my team, I always use the analogy of a game. It's a game, there's rules. There's people that get up from the table and say, I don't want to play anymore. How do you get them back onto the table? Because otherwise the game doesn't work. You know, there's people that invent new rules and you have to hold them back because otherwise the game doesn't work either. There's people that are upset at each other, but they have to work together or else the game doesn't work. Well, you can do a lot with this game analogy and it's very simple and everybody can relate to it, right? I sometimes said, well, you know, this person's playing backgammon and you're playing tennis. So what do we do to make sure that we're all playing the same game, which is really Monopoly? It's something completely different.
It's fascinating. So you're a guy who's very well educated, and in the world of expression and communication. So there's a favorite theme. There's this college professor in marketing that I remember fondly, and I think you were involved in one of these discussions with
Yes.
Dr. Ken Lloyd about myopia. In other words, not
Yes.
seeing the world as you should see it, or could possibly see it. Marketing myopia is fog. And for the audience out there, if you don't mind me repeating a little bit, this professor used the New York Central Railroad as an example of a company that could have done a lot of different things with all the land that they owned and the tracks. They could have owned more land. They could have developed the land with factories or housing all along the tracks. And the New York Central did not do that. They just wanted to sell tickets for passengers, but mainly fill box cars with freight and ship it long distance. They did that pretty well, but they didn't think of themselves as in the world of transportation, not to mention the development of the asset base, as clearly as they should have. So, for instance, they could have started or partnered with Southwest Airlines. They could have partnered with land developers, area economic development experts, brokers, as well as investors. But they didn't do that. And so New York Central is now out of business, merged into one or the other. And Warren Buffett and his companies own, I think, the biggest trains and everything connected with trains and transportation, in the world. Right here in San Diego, the BNSF, or whatever it's called, it's a merger of several rail lines. San Diego Port is a shipping port, is a major inbound of cars and other things, but cars is huge. And they're put on the train tracks, which are right next to the seaport. And the train tracks go right down the street from where I'm sitting right now, 24/7, mainly at night. And they go up the coast to San Bernardino Riverside. And from there, the tracks go across the country, as well as north. So it's a major transportation corridor right down the street here. And what they have done is to further develop their technology of doing things better, faster, even cheaper, but they have not acquired any airlines or ocean shipping. So what do you think of that from a marketing point of view and a management point of view? And the concept is easily said, well, they just stick to the knitting that they know and didn't branch off.
Well, to me, this is a question of outsourcing and partnering. And it is something that, of course, you see in relocation and mobility all the time. And it comes up in a lot of the first calls you have with your transferees because they don't understand why there isn't just one person doing it all. And as soon as you start explaining to them, well, you can't have somebody doing your expenses and, you know, hauling your sofa around. They get it. So the whole model is based on one point of communication. That's a relocation consultant. As I said, the person that controls the timeline. But then there's all these different specialists in their field. They could be real estate agents. Typical example is it's two. It's one at origin and one at destination. Well, most likely they're not. The person at origin can't be a specialist at the destination, vice versa. That makes sense, right? So you explain that model, and it's, like I said, very similar to what you just outlined. And you say, ultimately, it's all about the end result. It's all about getting you there. But you need to have a lot of people that do what they do, that are specialized in what they do, in order to make that happen. And whenever you talk about, oh, there he is. Whenever you talk about railroad, I think of my history lectures that I had in college. I did a lot of American history and a lot about city development, right? First, you build the rail line, the railroad line, you sell the plots of land, you build the infrastructure. All of a sudden, there's a city there in the middle of nowhere, in the prairie. And that's how you bring the West forward. That's how you move the frontier. I learned all that stuff in college. And it was the same thing. It was a railroad line working with land developers, having plans, drawing up. We saw in my professor showed us all these plans of these communities that never existed because somebody went bankrupt. But this whole concept of, yeah, you just, if you build it, they will come, and so on. Coming from Europe, where your average city is 1,000, if not 2,000, if not even older, years old. It's fascinating, right? It's totally unusual. I mean, I grew up in a house that was built in 1753. Normal.
Well,
Yeah.
so we want to welcome Michael Jackson. Welcome.
Hi, thank you.
It's a pleasure to meet you. I've gotten many CRP and GMS credits from listening to you speak.
Oh, well, wonderful. Well, glad to help your recertification.
Thank
And
you.
thank you for being certified.
Okay,
Absolutely.
this is Christian Turnedin, and he's also in Southern California. And although he's between jobs right now, he has deep experience in mobility and other things. So why don't you fill him in, Christian, on your
Okay,
background?
sure. Yeah, happy to. So I was born in Germany, moved to Switzerland when I was 9 years old. My dad is German, my mom is Swiss, and moved from Switzerland to the United States in 2000, got into mobility in about 2004, and worked for two different relocation management companies. But as we talked about, Ed and I, at the beginning of this show, my background, my degrees in linguistics and English and history, and we talked about using communication skills that I acquired and studied in college in mobility and project management in general, but mobility as well as in marketing, because I also worked in marketing. And by the way, I'm very happy with the new ARMS, with the new WERC website, all the marketing you've done. I also worked a little bit with Alexa Schlosser, published an article in the blog, and I have the second one almost ready to go. So she said I could publish another one. And that's going to happen sometime in the next month or two. So it's great what you guys are doing.
Great, thank you. Pleasure to meet you. And
Likewise.
and yes, and excited that you're putting forward another article and in for publication.
Thank you. I am too.
So Michael Jackson, why don't you do a better job than me introducing you to our global audience? You are currently an executive within WERC, which is worldwide ERC, employee relocation. So tell us better than I just did
Oh,
about
thank you.
what you're doing and what your
Yeah.
current role is.
Absolutely. And so, I am the, I at WRC, I'm the Vice President of Member Engagement and Public Policy. And so I oversee a couple of portfolios, including our public policy work and working with our four public policy forums and the 120 plus volunteer members from across the industry and from around the world, you know, that engage on, you know, in supporting us and being able to track and advise on how to navigate a whole range of public policy issues, whether it's, you know, compliance matters around data security, immigration, tax, you know, the changing landscape around North American real estate and mortgage. And so, you know, engaging members across the industry and individuals across the industry is critical for us to be able to you know, engage with policymakers on the changing, changing landscape that's impacting talent mobility, and being able to make sure that mobility professionals have the tools and information on, you know, the changing landscape to be able to support their organizations and the various transferees that they support, either internally or, you know, as a service provider through. And so, you know, so a lot of moving pieces on the public policy front. You know, we're actually gearing up right now with our GWS event next month in Washington. We're having an advocacy day where we'll have talent mobility professionals going up on Capitol Hill to, you know, to engage with policymakers in both the House and the Senate with the U.S. Congress on a range of issues. And so the two primary issues are going to be reinstating the moving tax expense deduction, which a decision on that is, you know, the future of that's to be decided in the next 16 months. And so, you know, engagement's already underway, you know, both by WRC, but also in our coalition with the American Trucking Association, International Association of Movers, and others, you know, up on Capitol Hill. But over the next 16 months, you know, critical, you know, to shaping the future of the moving tax expense deduction is going to be, you know, congressional offices hearing from members from across our industry what has been the impact of not having the tax expense deduction on companies and transferees since 2017, and what would it mean, you know, for individuals, for companies, and for the U.S. economy to have it, you know, to have it back. And this is where ultimately that, you know, as an industry, we support, you know, in the ballpark, you know, of 250 to 300,000, you know, transferees, you know, transferring across the United States each year, you know, and so, you know, this, you know, this impacts a lot of lives of people, you know, and one of the most critical milestones in their, you know, professional and personal lives, you know, for themselves, their families, and, you know, and having this, you know, will have a direct impact on these individuals, but then also on their employers, but then also allow for innovation and advancement that supports the U.S. economy. So this is it's a critical issue for our industry, but for business overall, and for being able to support, the talent workforce within, and being able to make sure folks are able to, move for employment purposes, to be able to further their professional careers and support the employers that they're working for. And so that's going to be a critical issue for us, along with advocating for modernizing the U.S. employment-based immigration system, and being able to hear, you know, and have policymakers hear directly from talent mobility professionals that are at the front lines, you know, what the impacts have been of, you know, not being, of the challenges of being able to get access to visas that, you know, that are needed to be able to move talent, but then also, you know, the challenges that U.S. companies and employers have faced related to the adjudication process around visas and the compliance elements. And so how can we make the process more efficient to be able to support U.S. employers and individuals that are engaging, you know, and utilizing U.S. employment-based immigration channels?
So, Michael, if I can ask you, I'm sorry, one second. Are you a registered lobbyist?
We have a registered lobbyist that works with our, you know, that does our direct lobbying on Capitol Hill, and, you know, an individual by the name of Tristan North, who we've worked with for the last 12 years, and and many of you are probably familiar with, has
Absolutely.
been a long time collaborator with WERC, but he is our registered lobbyist that works directly on Capitol Hill.
And so is he shepherding the group on October 22?
So it's going to be, we're going to have, it's a combination of folks. And so we're going to have, right now we've got, approximately 50 folks registered and more folks that are coming through, the registration process. So we're going to have groups of folks probably, that are going to be in paired into groups of probably, 5 to 7 folks per group, engaging with differing offices in both the House and Senate. And so, it's going to be, and so there'll be, groups will be led by a range of industry leaders, including leaders from our public policy forums, and so it'll be a real mix. But again, this is the industry coming together to advocate and to advance, key issues that are critical for talent mobility.
Fascinating, Christian.
I was going to say, Michael, I won a green card in the green card lottery, and that allowed me to come and live and work in the United States. And every time I hear about how long it takes to get a green card these days, I'm just so grateful that in my case it only took about 2 years. And in fact, because I had the green card, my then girlfriend, now wife, and I had to move within a reasonable time frame. So the burden was on us to move quickly and to, accelerate the whole process rather than to just sit around and wait for a green card. It breaks my heart to hear these stories of how long some people are waiting.
No, absolutely. And this is an area that, becomes a real issue for companies in terms of, being able to retain key talent, particularly when you look at sort of the evolution, of the talent pipeline, and again, the challenges at different steps along the way from getting, from getting recent grads, that may be, say, international students, some of the challenges of, how do you, connect them in? But then if you want to, continue that relationship longer term with them, the challenges with those options. And so it's a real challenge for employers, navigating their talent strategies throughout, but also, has real ramifications for individuals, and that's, and as you pointed out, the waits can be very, very extensive depending on the circumstances, and that has impacts on employers and individuals, both the employee and their families. And so, so these, this question is one that, it's very much top of mind for, for employees, because employers and their employees, because it's, again, it's such a critical piece of, the talent mobility process and the talent pipeline.
And these people can go someplace else. They can go to Canada. They could go to Australia. The United States is competing oftentimes to have these people live here, but also stay here long term, which is what the green card would be doing. So I've had transferees who moved to Canada instead of moving to the United States. I've experienced that listening to what they went through.
Yeah, and this is where for our industry, one of the major challenges right now is that you've got shifting landscapes in so many countries, not just in the United States, and challenges, within. You've got, changing governments, and we just had a change of government in the UK,
That's
and
right.
in the UK has recently increased the fees associated with various immigration related services. Similar, occurred in the US earlier this year. You've got Canada that has been, there's been reports of tightening of various, temporary employment mechanisms, but looking ahead into a broader context of parliamentary elections, having to occur sometime in the next year in Canada, that could, result in, depending on the outcome of the election, a change of government, in Canada, which could then impact, how employ, what options employers may have, in Canada. And so, and then, you've got elections in Germany, and we could go down the list. It was, I think, over 65 countries this year, plus probably another 20 or so lined up next year, where elections were being held at the presidential or parliamentary level. So lots of, these, this shifting landscape and the impact of elections has very real ramifications for our industry, particularly when our industry, is responsible for moving people throughout, from so many parts of the world. And, and mobility professionals, have to look at the navigating landscape, oftentimes not just in one country, but a whole portfolio of countries spanning multiple continents.
So I am on the periphery, as you know, in PR and marketing, and I'm not a realtor or household goods specialist or a corporate. I've spent my life in marketing things on the periphery and public relations and publications and conferences, very connected for a long time with the mobility industry, as you know, but just for the benefit of the outside audience. So I have to ask about the role of why bother relocating talent into the US? Why can't you just hire them to be wherever they are and they work remotely?
And so, and that's,
Of course, that
it,
depends on
yeah,
the specific job function.
yeah, and that gets, and it's a good question. And that's where, with a lot of, a lot of companies, it's a, it's a balanced portfolio of, building up the skill sets within your local communities, whether it's the US or whatever countries where you have operations, building up in the, in a lot of, companies, large and small, are investing in, in those skills development, particularly in more of the technical fields, to be able to get, to make sure that they've got, local workforces within. But, but there's also needs and areas within where there may not, there may be those skills gaps where you're not able to, to get in, where you need to look at moving talent, in some form to be able to let, to address that business function, or to be able to support the, the movement, of, short-term assignments and, executive levels. And so there's a whole mix of, of circumstances. And I think for, and that's where this question of, sort of the talent strategy for companies is so critically important, and where mobility, has, a critical partnership and is a critical intersection of, being able to, to be able to say, here's what the company's looking at, here's how, sort of the variables, to think about with XYZ, and really be, and what we've seen is mobility, and Christian, you can, certainly, probably talk about this as well, mobility as a strategic partner, being able to be a part with their, with the, their HR business partners, with the CHROs, with the,
That's right.
the business units, being able to say, if here's what you're looking at in your talent strategy across the different areas, from new hires in and sort of that pipeline and sort of university pipeline, new hire in, or to experienced executives, and sort of what are the opportunities here if you're thinking about XYZ. What are the compliance considerations, whether it's immigration, tax, sort of the logistics of moving people in, and then what would the cost be for all of this? And so ultimately, it, it's, for companies, it's a whole combination of factors within the, within their talent strategies within. But this is where, our, as talent mobility, our role, is an opportunity to be able to really be that strategic partner with HR and others, advising on that, but, and being able to advise, if you, if we look at XYZ, here are the ramifications, what it means, and particularly in an evolving landscape where you've got shifting immigration tax requirements, where you have, differing, differing compliance requirements, you've got shifting costs with, a range of things, whether, across the supply chain. So that, that seat at the table is, it's increasingly become a critical part of the function, but across our industry. But that, allows companies to be able to have that bifurcated and multifaceted, approach with, to how they manage talent. Christian, go ahead.
Thank you. So you just kind of described my dream job. That's what I'm looking for. As Ed mentioned, I'm between jobs at the moment. And my angle is very practical. The tagline I've come up with, I know what works and what doesn't in mobility. And seeing myself as the partner, I would be the person who definitely assists with those strategies, but with a very strong practical angle. And a great example for that is visa and immigration. A lot of people, let's say hiring managers, have no idea how long it takes to get a visa processed. And they want people at the new location, in 3 weeks. And then you have to tell them, you can be whoever you want. It's not going to happen like that because you're dealing with governmental entities and they don't care what you want. You can expedite it. You can pay for, expedited service to get that visa done. But ultimately, they make the rules. And you have to play, again, I'm using the game analogy. You have to play that game and you have to play within those rules. The mobility partner then comes in and explains what can be done when, going back to what I said earlier about the timeline. And then they can add how. And of course, they can, as Michael just said, also give an idea with a cost estimate of how much it's going to cost. And with regards to what you said, Ed, earlier with your question about why do people have to move, one of the examples there would be an expansion into another area of the United States or into another country. If you build a plant, you can't work remotely. You have to have people on the ground, and you may not be able to get the people you need as quickly as you need them there. So what do? You send a team of explorers, you send a team of people, pioneers, people that set it all up. And then once that's established and makes money and so on and so forth, then you start hiring locally. But you need to have people in place that know how to hire locally, right? All of this has to come from somewhere. It's not just there overnight.
So to that, and that's a really good point you make. So the CHIPS and Science Act was developed by Samsung's public policy leader, and Michael, you met her at my meeting February 1 at the law firm, and she wrote, well, along with others, that CHIPS and Science Act, and Congress passed it and President Biden signed it. And they've targeted billions of dollars to relocate, to build up, relocate and build up the chips manufacturer in the US, different areas, including Central Texas, where there's an economic boom because of that development, and in Arizona, Chandler area. But the problem has been, one of the problems has been the inability to find sufficient numbers of talented people who are currently available in the US who can work in that advanced, whatever it's called, chips chips development and manufacture in Texas and Arizona. So the whole thing is just delay, 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 even though they've already started the construction in both places. So the immigration conundrum is directly tied to what they've already allocated in a legal way to solve a problem and create opportunities. I don't know what I'm talking about anymore beyond that,
No, you
Michael.
just gave an example of what you just said, right? You want a factory in Texas and you want to make chips. Okay, but you got to staff it somehow. How are you going to do that if your immigration policy is such that it becomes very difficult to staff that as quickly as you want it to? You just illustrated what your question. That's one of the examples.
Yeah, well, and this gets to the, again, that multifaceted approach of which for companies of which immigration, is a critical part of it, but also with this is the development of that local pipeline. And
Right.
this is where the, partnerships with, with secondary and post-secondary institutions, to attract, students or to retrain employ, individuals, professionals, in the skills that are needed in, there's a whole, that, takes time to build out, but ultimately, builds in that, that long-term, support for, for that within. But then you've also got the needs of, how do you address that skills gap in that, in that interim period, looking at talent that you may have or a talent that you may need to, bring in from elsewhere to either help get a system up and running or a plant up and running. And we see this very commonly with a, like a new production facility where a company may bring, may bring managers over or individuals over, to help, help support that, that the startup and opening of that new facility, connected, and particularly if you've got similar technologies within. And so, but this involves the movement of talent, even if it's for a short-term purpose within. And
Right.
so this is where, the these elements often, have to be interconnected in terms of your workforce development, but then also, how can you, how do you, how can you move talent that you need to either address skills gap or to make sure that the support, the standing up and, of new operations or expanding operations or evolving operations. And so ultimately, this is where, and, for employers that, that immigration piece is a critical piece because for many employers, it, there are needs that come in, even if they have prime, primarily a US-based and, workforce with US employees. But, but I, but this is where the challenges with this, with, the employers face with employment-based immigration processes and access to visas can have very tangible impacts on the US economy and our competitiveness for being able to address these critical issues for, they're important for our economic competitiveness, for national security on down the list, but then also being competitive with so many other parts of the world.
If you
Okay.
want an example for the what you just said, Michael, about the post-secondary approach, look at the history of the city of Irvine. There's no coincidence that they built a university in Irvine. Irvine is master plan. They knew what they were doing. They were thinking, well, give it a bit of time, and then we're going to have people who are highly skilled, highly educated people that are in Irvine, and they're going to maybe be working for companies that are in Irvine, so we can attract more companies that are in Irvine. City of Irvine has grown even while I used to live there for like 2 years. It's almost unrecognizable from what it was like in the early 2000s.
It's area economic development, long-term planning, and the relocation industry is directly connected to area economic development, particularly FDI, foreign direct investments. So, I applaud the new direction of WERC. I think it's great. Anupam was a guest speaker at a New York City meeting I produced. It was hosted, this is about 10 years ago. He is a venture capitalist at the time, I think was Silver Lake, at the, I'm not sure. And I forget how I got introduced to him, but I invited this guy who I'd never met before through LinkedIn. I found him, and he came. So, His at the time, his office was in the Chrysler Building in Midtown Manhattan, and my meeting was scheduled to be in the tower above Penn Station. And my host sponsor was United Health at that time, and so they in their boardroom they hosted me, and we had around 50 people around that huge table. And Anupam spoke. I forget what he talked about at the time. It was not recorded, but it was really interesting. You could see the smarts and the energy and the depth of master planning. Thinking things out and then finding pieces, people to implement the pieces. And I could see that's what he's doing now. So
No,
that's cool.
absolutely. And I think I think the other, piece of this, and I think one of the things as we, and particularly, over the last, I would say, year to 18 months, just seeing, the industry really come together to support the industry. And I think,
Yes.
and as Anupam and myself and others have been going across the country, just hearing from members and just, folks wanting to step up and say, how can I support, how can I support this industry? And being able to, being able to address the range of changes and, issues that we're facing, but also, looking at the opportunities that we have in this evolving landscape as an industry to be able to really demonstrate and articulate the value. And so whether it's been the changes in the US real estate sector around buyer broker compensation, or helping employers think through, how do mobility practitioners, navigate the immigration challenges we just talked about, to looking at sort of how does what does mobility look like, with an evolving, workplace, with evolving, policies around remote, hybrid, in-person work, around, technology and its impacts, within, and how that shapes, opportunities and challenges within. But just seeing the industry come together, bring their expertise and insights, but then also really, looking toward provide, resources and solutions to really help, propel the talent mobility as an industry. It's been really encouraging to see, the industry come together and to be able to see the real power of talent mobility when we, when we come together to address critical issues that face us as an industry. And so I think that, I think, it's an exciting time to be a talent mobility professional. There's a lot of challenges, there's a lot of change, within, but there's a lot of opportunity, that we have. And I think that this is where, the value and the skills, that mobility professionals have. And I think, Christian, you were talking about this earlier, that, just the range of skills that you have to have as a talent mobility professional, that, for us, as practitioners, is more important than ever, and to be able to help employers be able to navigate this changing landscape. And so the challenge for us is that we have to be familiar with a whole, ever-growing range of things, as we have new countries that, we may be operating with, as technologies change, laws change, what, technology, whatever the it may be. But then, but that creates an opportunity for us to be able to connect those dots and to be that strategic partner that then feeds into HR, to the business unit, the finance, and to really, really continue that, a lot of the shifts that we've seen in the last couple of years, particularly with pandemic, changes, where, the compliance pieces, we were positioned to be that partner helping to navigate the challenges therein. And so it's a it, there's a lot of moving pieces, but there's a lot of opportunity within. And so, and I think this is where, the conversations like what we're having here, I think the are the big changes and big issues, this is the time, and the opportunity for talent mobility to to step up, to come together to support the industry. And for me, that's been one of the things I've been most encouraged to see. And I think continuing that connection in and that, and leveraging that, by the people for the people in terms of really propelling and advancing talent mobility is more important than ever and critical for our success as an industry and ultimately to support the success of our employers, whatever they may be, but then also the transferees that we support.
So the real estate conundrum now with buyer brokerage, and I know that you guys are certainly looking into it with the likes of Teresa Howe and the Relocation Directors Council. So there has to be a simpler way to communicate the new rule. And do you want to add a brief statement as we come to a close of this?
Yeah, no, absolutely. I would say this has been one of those areas that, where the industry really has come together. And, seeing in WRC, we've worked closely with, as you mentioned, RDC and a relocation appraisers and consultants and a range of stakeholders across the industry, and have pulled together subject matter experts from over 60 volunteers into an ad hoc group from across the industry verticals, whether it's broker, corporate, service, RMC, sort of title closing, mortgage and lending on down the list, to look at sort of the impacts across the various areas. And this is where the challenge for, for the industry overall has been that the changes occurring have not, there's not been a one solution, change within this because it really is varied depending on location because you've got differing forms, differing processes, depending on the requirements. Some states having state laws that guide this, and some states, including, New Jersey has just passed something. California has something on the governor's desk, that, related to this. So there's an, this is something that's still very much continuing to evolve. And then we've got, a number of key question marks about, what the Department of Justice may, may weigh in on this, with the proposed settlement that NAR has put forward and that's being operationalized even while the legal elements of this are still, still proceeding. But this is a, so, the challenge has been that is it really is not a, there's not a one solution answer here. And it really depends on a whole range of factors. But this is where the industry coming together to navigate the various nuances and really focusing on education, communication, and partnership, across all of the ecosystems has been critical the last 6 months and will continue to be critical as sort of this landscape continues to shape out in the coming months.
I congratulate you on this analysis and clear thinking on that. Thank you very much. Yes, Christian.
So to answer your question, Ed, why isn't there an explanation? Oh, Michael just said why there isn't an explanation today, but I would also tell you there will probably be an explanation a year from now or 2 years from now that will be a whole lot simpler. Because I think not only will it involve, but there will be all these scenarios. There will be all these combinations of factors when you have, this and this scenario and this state, and this happens. And with all of this, it will become much more linear to say, in the majority of cases, you can expect this outcome. And at that point, I'm very optimistic here since you talked about being optimistic for the opportunities in the mobility industry. I'm optimistic that there will be a much easier explanation once we have a bit of experience under our collective belts.
Yeah, and I think this is where the next, I think the next, 6 to 12 months is going to be critical for seeing sort of how, a lot of the, a lot of the dust settles on this, and I think seeing sort of what the trends look like and then how that plays out in terms of both the Department of Justice, sort of the state elements within this, but then also seeing as the real estate market shifts and, how that then factors into what the, how this impacts, how this plays out for transferees and companies. And so I think that as we have a very much a shifting real estate market overall, right now, and particularly, seeing sort of what happens, now that we've seen the Fed's actions to, cut interest rates earlier this week, seeing how that plays out as and what further actions, occur and how that impacts the ecosystem. But also seeing a lot of the regional trends, because right now there's a lot of differing trends depending on which market you're looking at. And so I think one of the challenges with real estate overall is that, there can be, a number of overarching themes, but, a lot of variance depending on which market you're talking about and which elements within. So I think as things progress, I think you're going to see, a number of elements settle, but it's going to still continue to be, an element where you're going to have a whole range of factors to work through. But that's where the expertise, within brokerages and leveraging relocation directors to be able to, help support the, those variances and expertise and helping navigate the value of relocation management companies providing
Right.
that strategic leadership, but then also the value of corporate mobility professionals to be able to, to set those, expectations, to be able to shepherd that and to leverage their partner networks, whether it's the RMC, corporate mortgage and lending on down, to navigate this ecosystem. This is where the value of, all of the elements is more critical than ever to be able to help provide that partnership, to be able to navigate, the changing ecosystem, not just with this issue, but I think across the real estate sector. And we're seeing similar things on immigration, tax, a whole range of things. This is where the industry and, and the partnerships and collaboration within, across both corporates and service providers is more important than ever for helping, to navigate the changing landscape. And so this is where the expertise and the familiarity that mobility professionals have is so critical for being able to provide, the information that transferees and companies need to navigate.
So thank you for coming on Global TV Talk Show. This has been a program which started out today about stress and anxiety when looking for a job, and now we've been talking about stress and anxiety about all these changes that are happening, and yet the solution is partnership and discussion and communication.
Education.
And I think the last thing I would add one thing to that, and I think it's, well, two things. I think self-care and grace. I think, whether you're looking for a new job or navigating a changing workplace landscape or navigating the range of changes that we're dealing with within the industry, self-care, making sure that you're taking care of yourself, is more important than ever. And
Yes.
This is where the airline adage of making sure that you put your oxygen mask on
Yes.
before you help others is so critically important. But then also grace in terms of being able to, there it is, there are it, there is volatility, there is change. With that comes stress. And and just having the grace with each other, with our teams, with our partners, within to navigate. And again, keeping that the eye on that North Star of, we ultimately as an industry, function best and are able to address major issues when we work together, to come through. And so the power of us collectively, it's not always, it's not always easy, but that's where, grace is so important, particularly in times of change. And so I think not losing sight of the self-care and the grace, whether we're talking about, dealing with, job transition or job searching or navigating changes and change, within employment, within the industry. I think those two things, in addition to what you said, are just absolutely critical.
Michael,
Thank you
to
very much.
summarize the article that I'm working on with Mehiba Hill.
Oh,
That's
that's great. So,
exactly what we're writing about.
I'll see you in Washington on that day, Tuesday. Mayor Brown, the law firm, is hosting my workshop. It's just a small workshop, but we're focusing in on global business talent. And we're also focusing in on cybersecurity threat and defenses. So it's a C-suite event, small, compact, but very high quality. So we'll see you on the street somewhere.
Perfect.
All right. Thank you for being on Global
Thank you. So
TV.
nice
I'm
meeting you
Christian.
finally. Thank
Great
you.
to have you, Christian.
Thank you. Appreciate
And learned so much about linguistics. I had no idea.
it.
Michael,
No,
thank you for your time.
absolutely wonderful to be on, and look
Thank
forward
you
to
so much.
the seeing you all, and hopefully many of you watching in DC at the GWS next month.
Yes, okay. You'll both get a copy of this video sometime later today. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you. Take care.
Take care.
Thank you.
Have a nice
Bye-bye.
weekend.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.